I'm Brook Lee, and this is Modern Wahine Hawaii. Welcome to Modern Wahine Hawaii, everybody. We're back at a familiar place, Kumu Kahua, and I'm here with Lois Yamanaka.
Hello.
Hi, Lois.
Hi.
How are you?
I'm doing well, thank you.
I'm so excited that we're back here at Kumu Kahua. What is your connection with Kumu Kahua? How did you get started with theater?
I think early on in my, I didn't even consider myself a writer, but I met John Watt and Keith Kashiwada and Harry Wong. And they were exciting young people at the time. And I was really kind of blessed because when my book was published, they were able to do an adaptation of Wild Meat and the Bully Burgers. And they also did Heads by Harry. They did Saturday Night at the Pahala Theater. So my relationship with them is one of great trust because I take my babies and then my books, they go into the world, and then I put them in hands that I know will receive them with the kind of ability and...
And so when you guys started down this road, because it's kind of like a marriage in a lot of ways, because it's a work that's a piece of, it's in a book, and it lives its own world, and then to translate it into someone talking on stage, a full, you know, person, and the way they make choices, that's something that you have to have some sort of a consent in and like an idea about, and they have to check with you. That's where the trust comes in, right? And so I guess they're bringing it back. They're bringing the show in 2023. How are you feeling about that?
I'm really excited. You know, it's been, I want to say 30 or 30 plus years.
Been?
Yeah.
Wow.
And then the little girl who played Calhoun, she has a child now.
Right.
And then, you know, like, so it's a whole different kind of feeling for me coming back to the work, coming back to the theater now, and then being able to see the work in action again. The first time was kind of interesting because when I sat in the dark theater and looked down at the set and the actors on the set, it was kind of surreal because it was like I was sitting in God's seat and watching people like chess pieces move around.
Well, because you're the writer, so it's like your brain, and then you see it in person, and you're like,
it's
well, that was
really
in my head.
Odd. It's
right.
So, it's such an odd experience to see them come to life in that way, but surprising and very, very exciting, you know?
And so what do you think it'll be different this time around? Because the world has changed so much in the last 3 decades.
I think so, but I think literature, the life of a book and its relevance become different. It changes as we pass through the years, but it still is a piece of work that will survive everything, I hope, you know.
What is it about Kumu Kahua? Like, any theater could have approached you.
Yeah.
I mean, not any theater, let's be honest. Kumu Kahua is a unicorn in and of itself, but why Kumu Kahua Theater, you think? What is it, what makes this place so special?
The people here, you know, the people who've given their lives to this kind of vision, it's important to be part of that kind of journey with them. And it's been very rewarding for me in my life to have that relationship with the theater, with the guys, with Harry and Keith, and now Donna and John Watt, and to be able to be a part of their collaboration.
Right.
It's just something very good.
I mean, the interesting part to me is usually people write they write a theater piece. It's a theatrical like thing that they're in their head from the beginning. This is where you come in and you don't.
Right.
When you adapt something from a book, it's a different animal.
It
so
is.
Things have to sort of be, choices have to be made.
Yeah.
And I feel like, I mean, I'm biased because I love Kumu Kahua, but you know, they are very respectful of where the art comes from.
Right.
It's not really just about how can we manipulate this piece to get as many people in the seats or turn them around or hit buttons or, you know, be relevant to what's in and what's, you know, they're like, we'll be unpopular. We don't care.
Yeah.
We want to tell this story because nobody's telling this story and it's important that it be told. And that's kind of gutsy because when you're looking at it from an ROI standpoint, some people are like, but Waitress sells, you know, but if we do Charlie and the Chalk Factory, people come, you know, and it's really admirable that Kumu Kahua is like, they come, they don't come, it's okay, because as long as we've done the work and we've marked the moment, and like you said before, representation has happened, that's all that we're really about at the end of the day.
It's kind of really remarkable to me, you know what I mean? I just, the process for me is once I turn the book over to the theater, I don't step in at all.
Oh, really?
They don't consult me, I don't want to be consulted, because it becomes a new
thing, right?
You know, and then it evolves in their hands. Mm-hmm. And I did my work, and now I hand it over to you, and I don't have any kind of hand in what they do, who they cast, you know.
That's
anything.
A lot of trust, though.
Right, yeah, it is.
That's a lot of trust.
That's why.
And so then when you come back and you see it, were you surprised? Were you like happy? Were you like,
I'm always surprised. I'm always very, very awed at the kind of work that they do and the kind of ways that they use this space to make it happen.
Right.
And it's always been very moving for me, and I'm so grateful, you know, that I've had them in my life all these years and they continue that relationship with me.
Well, I'm just glad that, you know, you being the talented person that you are was so generous to be able to see an extra vision and allow them the opportunity to step in and bring that story to a different type of life. Because it's really important that Kumu Kahua be able to tell local stories and support all art here in the islands. And the fact that you guys were able to, you know, work it out and be able to have that sort of trust just sets a precedence going forward for the next generation.
Exciting, so,
yeah.
I mean,
it's just next level, especially after 30 years, and to be bringing it back in season, the next season is going to be amazing. So thank you for coming on the show and for sharing all of your mana'o, and also for all of the work that you do to help represent all of us out there.
Thank you.
No.
Thank you, too.
Thanks for being on the show.
Thank you.
Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii here in Kumu Kahua Theater. I'm here with Danielle Zalapani. Obviously, you love Kumu Kahua. We're going to get to that in a minute. But you've done other projects. Can you like kind of just take us through a little bit of an IMDb rundown of some of the projects you've worked on here locally?
Sure. I think the first one was Mike and Dave Need Wedding Dates.
Oh, okay.
The Zac Efron, Adam Devine.
Yes.
After that, it was a lot of independent films.
Okay. We love independent.
Yeah, the Waikiki directed.
That's independent, but like big.
It is.
I mean, it took HIF by storm.
Which is cool.
It's lovely, especially since it's a local production, you know?
So
that was amazing. Congratulations on that.
Thank you.
And so did you start in theater first and then go to film, or did you kind of just do both at the same time?
I actually started in theater first here at Kumu in 2010. I got involved with Maui the Demigod, and I think it was 5 years later, after being through multiple shows here, I did a show called Not One But Two, and one of the producers saw it and put my name out to Chris Kahunahana, and that's kind of how that started.
Got it. And so what makes the average like person here come to Kumu Kahua? Like, I know it's an inner calling of sorts, because you kind of, people who gravitate towards this kind of hui, we call it, with Kumu Kahua, y'all are kindred spirits. There's something not off about you, but there's something like you guys are like listening to a very different siren call than the average other community theaters are in town. What do you think it is about Kumu Kahua that, what are you guys hearing on the breeze when you decide to come here instead of any of the other theaters are in town?
I think we hear our stories. You know, this is one of the, I almost want to say it's the only theater that really focuses on local playwrights.
Right.
You know, so instead of doing a remount of a show someplace else, more often than not, the first time you do a show, it's the first time you're doing a show.
Ever, for anybody.
Ever.
Right. And there's a real tangible like electricity to that, because, you know, you're not just doing the play that's been done every year around Christmas. You know what I'm saying? It's like, this thing's being born tonight. Buckle in, kind of a thing. And the energy is very different, I feel like.
Yeah, again, it goes back to telling our stories. Like, I actually learned a lot about, you know, Hawaiian history, just history of Oahu. A show that I did here was the Hilo Massacre. Wilcox's Shot, which talked about Robert Wilcox, you know, and it's also too, we get to kind of see how the other islands are.
Right.
Like Lois Ann Yamanaka, one of my favorite shows was Saturday Night at Pahala Theater. And we just took her book of poems and literally turned it into a play.
Right.
And
she, even when I was talking with her, she was like, that relationship, she's like, is trippy too, because in my head, it's a thing. And then it, people are walking around on a stage and she's like, you feel like, am I seeing what I'm seeing? Am I God right now? And are they like the big thing people in my head are now on the stage? So that's kind of a really neat sort of experience too, to be able to see something transmute. It's literally like alchemy to me. It's so amazing how Kumu Kahua was able to hone in on the stories that no one's really telling, but these playwrights are telling. But then, like, we're gonna just double down and we're gonna finance it, and we're gonna, if people come, they come. If they don't come, it's okay, because we're making the canon of the stories. That's the point, not the ticket sales. I mean, ticket sales are great.
Yes.
Don't get us wrong, but it's more important that we mark the moment and the story be told, and that's admirable. So what's the difference though for you? I mean, it's between doing this, is it different than film, or like when you do the independence, is kind of the same vibe?
It's definitely different, stage versus film, but I feel like doing all the years of theater here especially kind of helped prepare me for that, because everything moves a lot faster on a set.
Right.
Like there was an episode I did on NCS Hawaii where the scene was pretty much like blocked and built by adding more people to it in 20 minutes. And then on top of that, you have the crew moving around, like adjusting lights and, you know, moving things in and out, set dressers. And I feel like doing theater here helped me realize, like, you have to stay focused. You have to show up and know your lines. You know, you have to pay attention to what's going on so you don't smash into someone and then have to reset the whole take. And so I'm definitely grateful for all the theater experience I've had.
Yeah, I kind of equate it sometimes to being in a halau. I mean,
yeah.
You know, to me, it really was like, theater was really like, you show up, you got to do basics, you do your hula, you say, you start in the back line, you work your way up, and you got to put the sweat equity in, or it shows.
Yes.
It really does show. Otherwise, because TV can be really quick, they could find you, you know, like Tia Carrera them said, you know, I'm at a 7-Eleven, I'm buying sweet bread, somebody finds me, they throw me in front of a camera. It's a very different evolution than when you're showing up every day, maybe 7 people to 20 people show up that night for the show, but the show goes on. But we're doing the show, and that's where the sweat equity comes in. So,
and then I also feel like how you bring up a hello, there's like a familial feel to it too, because you spend so much time together.
And it's a close-knit unit. Yeah, that's, I've loved that about Kumu Kahua, because it seems like a tighter group than the average bear. And again, it sounds like I'm saying you guys are kind of oddballs, but you're not. You guys just, like, you march to a different beat. Like, Kumu Kahua has its own kind of vibe, and I've always been very admirable of that, because the vibe, it's been 51 years now.
Yes.
And the vibe has, like, you know, gone along with the times, but it's pretty much the same vibe. 51 years of, like, a very cool sort of, we're going to do what we're going to do. Y'all come along or don't go with that. It's like the cool kids. I love it. Well, thank you for coming on the show and for all of the work and representation you do, because Kumu Kahua really needs advocates, obviously, but like people that are really willing to like commit to the work. And then when you go off and you become a big star, you know, you can like sing the praises of Kumu Kahua and, you know, bring in the next generation. So it's always good to have that representation out there and be able to go on to the next adventure. So thanks for coming on the show.
Thank you for having me.
Yeah, don't go anywhere. We'll be right back. Welcome back to Modern Wahine Hawaii. I'm via Zoom with Justina Matos. Hi, Justina.
Hi, Brooke. How are you?
I'm good. I'm sad we couldn't catch up in person, but you know, you've been island hopping, world hopping, all of the things. We're just glad that we were able to connect, because we're talking about Kumu Kahua, which is close to your heart, close to my heart. Can you tell people how it is that you first got involved with Kumu Kahua?
Yeah, back in 1986, I was a freshman at UH Manoa, and they were doing 12th Night or whatever with James Grant Benton and Dando Cleaver. And I was lucky enough to be part of that cast and tour the state of Hawaii, doing the kind of local Shakespeare. So that was my first exposure to them. And then I acted with them. I was on their board of directors later as a graduate student. And then I also wrote my dissertation about them for my PhD.
And so you're on Mokuakiawe, right? You live on Hawaii Island these days and are a teacher out there. What does it mean when you write your dissertation on Kumu Kahua? Like, how does that even work?
Well, my main advisor for my research was Dennis Carroll, who was the founder of Kumu Kahua Theater. So I interviewed him. I interviewed other resources of people who were part of the early history of Kumu Kahua. I read a lot of books about different time periods in Hawaii. The focus was local theater of Hawaii. I had to research all the way back to, you know, what theater was like before that and when Western theater first became introduced in Hawaii and all of that in order to lay a foundation to be able to talk about Kumu Kahua theater.
You guys, I mean, there's a lot of theater, gratefully, here in Hawaii, a lot of different, very talented places that you can do and go and see and be a participant in the theater experience. But the Kumu Kahua experience is slightly different only because you guys choose to, I guess, put all the eggs in the basket of fostering original plays as opposed to just licensing things that, you know, are everywhere.
Yes.
Not everybody does that.
No, it's a really risky thing to do because it's new work. It takes longer to create. It's harder to develop because there's no template. There's no blueprint already in place. So you are creating everything from scratch and you don't know if it's going to work or not. It hasn't been proven anywhere else. So it is a risky enterprise. You have to depend on the loyalty of your supporters, the audience base that you've built over the years, and their interest in seeing their works, their lives reflected on stage.
So let's talk about this whole haumana experience, you know, when you're a kumu and you're teaching the next generation. What is like that? What does that look like for you?
What I really admire about them is they are so, what I've seen anyway, and I'm teaching college level, so I don't know, you know, what they're like in high school or anything, but the college students that I see of that generation are so empathetic and kind and emotionally generous and supportive of each other and of the underdog, if you will. So they are not, you know, we used to see things that you either this or you're that, and there's no in between. And Generation Z is like, no, it's a whole spectrum. It's all blended together, and you're just an individual within that. So they're very, I feel, kind-hearted and generous, and they will rally around the weakest member of the group, from what I've seen.
And I'm assuming it'll affect the way that they tell stories going forward, is because how you express yourself and what you decide to define yourself as and how you want to be perceived or see the world is a completely different paradigm, and I'm gonna have to navigate and tell that story that way.
Yeah, so there's no, it's not about ethnicity, it's not about sexuality, it's not about religion, it's, yeah, you, the individual, and how you, the lens through which you see the world. Yeah, it's very different.
That's gonna be an exciting chapter for Kumu Kahua.
Yeah, for sure. And the other interesting thing about Gen Z is they're so brave technologically.
True. Like,
you know, with these last 2 years with COVID and all the theaters having to shut down cold turkey, right? And we're all stuck in our homes. And we've had to move into this digital realm, and people are like, well, what is this? Is this theater? Is it film? You're not doing it to a live audience anymore. So what is it? This weird hybrid thing, right? But I feel like, yes, it is. It's this new frontier and this weird hybrid thing. And I think we're going to keep exploring in those areas. And I think that Gen Z, they're just fearless with the digital world and with technology, and they will just dive in and take us places that we can't even imagine right now, I think.
Yeah, that's also, I guess, the mixed blessing of what happened out of all the backside of the last couple of years, is that Kumu Kahua was able to open themselves up to outside of a black box experience, and people who had to move away or who couldn't get on island, or even people on island we couldn't congregate, were able to still connect and see the material and feel that same sort of a heartbeat. So you kind of got to just count your blessings. But thank you so much for coming on the show and for making time. You know, we love to be able to support Kumu Kahua anytime I can, because, you know, you guys are like, it's the little engine that could. 51 yes. years now, just chugging along.
Yeah.
You know, okay. It's like, we're just going to keep on keeping on.
Thank you so much, Brooke. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you. Don't go anywhere. We'll be right back.
Well, that's our show for today, Hawaii, here from 51 years of telling Indigenous stories at Kumu Kahua Theater. Thank you to all of the wonderful women that came on the show to share their mana'o with us. Lois Anyamanaka has a new book out. Make sure you check it out. There's also a teacher's guide in here as well. It's a wonderful book, Snow Angels, Sand Angels, so check it out at your local bookstore. Thank you to Danielle Zalapani for being on the show as well. She's going places, Hawaii. I'm telling you, I got that sixth sense. So keep an eye out for her. Mahalo to her for coming on to the show. And Yusina Matos, all the way from Moku Okeawe, for sharing with us all of the wonderful stories that she has with doing things here with Kumu Kahua. Let's remember, like, we got to tell these Indigenous stories, Hawaii. So let's support Kumu Kahua Theater when you can. If you want to get a membership here, or if you want to come down and see a show, it's very important that we represent and that we support the artists that are telling all of our stories, because representation matters. So let's socially distance where we can, wear our masks, wash your hands. I know I'm over it, you're over it, but this is just the way it's got to be for a little bit more longer. So let's just keep doing what we can to keep everybody safe, and I'll see all of you next week.